María Callas. Para generaciones de amantes de la ópera, Callas es conocida simplemente como la Divina. Era polémica, enigmática y temperamental, pero vaya cuerdas vocales.
She built inside her throat and her brain, her body, a technique, really a fantastic technique.
María Callas la han llamado tigresa y también monstruo sagrado. Y pueden apostar que se labró su reputación a lo difícil.
María had the kind of personality that seemed to have scandals swirling around her. People would get very violent.
At times she could be so loving and so sweet and so much fun to be with. And other times she could just be a monster.
Don't be in search of any scandal.
En este episodio de Mysteries and Scandals abordaremos la increíble historia de una reina del drama de fama mundial.
There was a terrible moment in which she herself talked about, in which she said she was in the bathtub and she actually saw the tapeworm coming out.
Este programa lo tiene todo: triunfos, tragedias y un doloroso triángulo amoroso.
This is one of the great love stories of the century. María Callas, you had Aristotle Onassis and Jackie Kennedy. All these three people collided.
De octubre de 1968, la aventura amorosa de 9 años entre la diva de la ópera María Callas y el magnate griego Aristóteles Onassis terminó. Onassis asombró al mundo al casarse con la ex primera dama Jacqueline Kennedy en la isla griega de Scorpios. En París, Callas se mostró serena y les dijo a los reporteros cuán feliz se sentía por los recién casados, pero por dentro estaba destrozada. El escritor, crítico y amigo de María, John Ardoin.
She spoke with great bitterness and unhappiness. Because she desperately loved him and she truly wanted to be his wife.
Ann Edwards es la autora de María Callas, una biografía íntima.
María's life was really a series of betrayals. Felt a betrayal by her mother, she felt a betrayal by her father, and she certainly felt deeply a betrayal by Onassis.
La historia de María Callas es un drama con más altos y bajos que un aria de Puccini. El público nunca se cansaba de esta soprano parecida a un cisne, que nació siendo un patito feo el 2 de diciembre de 1923 en Nueva York. La doctora Alma Bond es la autora de autobiografía de María Callas, una novela.
She was a huge baby. She weighed 12 pounds, 8 ounces. And the nurse brought her and handed her to her mother and said, here's your beautiful baby girl. And the mother said, a girl? I have a girl. What do I need another one for? Take her away.
¿No les parece la madre del año? La ex cantante María Chacha es la autora de Preparación Completa, una guía de audición para la ópera.
Her mother always favored her sister Jackie, who was older, much more attractive, slender.
She never thought her mother loved her, but when her mother decided that María was going to be an opera star, it gave her an interest in María.
A sus 13 años, María se vio obligada a dejar Nueva York y a su padre cuando su madre Evangelia se la llevó a Grecia para que estudiara canto.
Evangelia basically decided that she could not promote María's career as well in New York as she could in her native Greece.
El estilo lírico de María no era el típico de la época.
María's, of course, was one of the most individual of all sounds. And it was a voice for the first time that just didn't express beauty and love, and it expressed things like viciousness and hatred.
Habla la soprano Renata Scotto.
The quality of the voice of María Callas was not that beautiful. She had a sound, it was really unusual.
En 1947, a sus 23 años, María se sentía frustrada por no encontrar trabajo.
And suddenly, from left field, came this wonderful offer for María to go to Verona, to a pier in the summer theater.
And there, in Verona, she met a businessman, Battista Menanghini, who fell madly in love with her.
He was 28 years older. He was a wealthy industrialist, but he dropped his work and he really managed her career.
Meneghini también hizo que María usara un anillo. La pareja se casó en 1949. Dos años después, Callas hizo su debut en el famoso teatro La Scala de Milán, Italia.
Her career was starting to blossom around then. After a few years, she began to feel very, first of all, hurt by the criticisms about her weight.
Callas no era exactamente esbelta, por lo que la diva comenzó un obsesivo, por no decir extraño, programa de dietas.
Her model for this transformation was none other than the very slender Audrey Hepburn.
El reportero Nicholas Gage es el autor de Fuego Griego.
She went on this diet and she swallowed eggs of tapeworms and developed tapeworms.
Atención, actrices principiantes de Hollywood, no intenten esto.
There was a terrible moment in which she herself talked about, in which she said she was in the bathtub and she actually saw the tapeworm coming out.
Por desgracia, Weight Watchers no existía. 18 meses después, Callas había pasado de 84 kilogramos a tan solo 47.
And she looked like a complete goddess. And you could see the beautiful bone structure and the gorgeous eyes. People were just enraptured with her. It was a stunning transformation. Now she was truly the package.
Con su delgadez que podía ser considerada extrema, María Callas tenía el mundo de la ópera a sus pies. Al regreso, la divina es motivo de titulares con un romance bastante notorio. Para 1956, a sus 32 años, María Callas ya era legendaria, y no solo por su voz. La talentosa diva también tenía la reputación de ser extremadamente exigente y propensa a las rabietas. En fin, lo que se espera de una estrella de la ópera.
Why in Dallas and not here? That is what we're after him.
Maria was in Dallas rehearsing and singing the only Medea she ever sang in America when Rudolph Bing fired her from the Metropolitan Opera. The conflict was a contract she refused to sign.
I will consider you a breach of agreement and contract terminated.
But Bing had her alternating in the parts, and she said, my voice isn't in the elevator. It can't go up and down.
I cannot change artists every performance. Now you can know it. Each performance we have, if we do 10 Macbeths, 10 different tenors, 10 baritones. So I'm sorry, I can't do that. That's not hard.
Temperament, it's part of being an artist. We are temperamental because it's part of being a performer.
Al parecer, Callas siempre estaba actuando. Dentro o fuera del escenario, María sabía cómo lidiar con sus admiradores y con la prensa.
She became friends with Elsa Maxwell, who was one of the great gossip reporters. And at a party that Elsa gave, she met Onassis.
They started to dance, and she was half a head taller than he is. And she started to bend down, and he said, you don't have to crouch. People say I'm much taller when I'm standing on my money.
He invited her and her husband to go to the Christina, his yacht, and take part in a cruise.
And she kept refusing, and finally she went with her husband. On the cruise, they became enchanted with each other.
They would talk till all hours of the night. And for Callas, it was the first time that she'd ever really been in love.
The same night that she made love with Onassis, she went to her husband. She said, our marriage is over. I'm in love with Ari.
On August 17th, Onassis showed up at the Meneghini home, and Maria left with him. She just walked out on her husband.
Recordemos que Ari todavía estaba casado con Tina Onassis y que el esposo de María estaba decidido a hacer lucir al magnate como el villano.
Batista cursed them and then went to the press and disclosed this affair, and then all hell broke loose.
María desapareció misteriosamente de la luz pública durante 7 meses, recluyéndose en el yate Cristina.
María did not perform from November 19, 1959, until the summer of 1960. She usually performed 20, 25 times a month.
La teoría de Nicholas Gage es que María estaba embarazada de Ari y no quería ser vista en público.
Now, what happened is when she got to the eighth month, María was kind of despondent.
Mientras Ari estaba en el Caribe por negocios, María y su médico habrían decidido que el bebé nacería por cesárea en el octavo mes de embarazo, algo que resultó ser fatal.
The baby died after it was born because she wanted it born by cesarean earlier than was really safe to do.
El bebé prematuro nació el 30 de marzo de 1960 y murió el mismo día.
The baby was named Omero and only lived a few hours. This is new information that's come out. I don't know if it's going to be refuted by anyone who's left who can refute it.
I was able to get the birth certificate, the death certificate from the municipality of Milan. I have an actual picture of the baby found among Maria's most intimate papers.
De haber vivido, todo habría sido diferente. ¿Quién sabe? Al regreso, María Callas pierde a su hombre, su voz y la voluntad de vivir. Durante 9 años, del 59 al 68, María Callas tuvo un tempestuoso romance con uno de los hombres más ricos del mundo, Aristóteles Onassis. El romance tenía el fuego y la pasión de una historia de amor y la tristeza y la angustia de una tragedia griega.
To perform in Greece, he bought Scorpios. It became sort of their sanctuary. And he was very attentive to her.
She loved him deeply, and she wanted very much to be his wife.
Now, the problem was, while Onassis got a divorce, Maria's husband will not give her a divorce. So if he had, I think they would have married in 1960 after the birth of the baby.
María habría dejado su carrera para convertirse en la esposa de Aristóteles Onassis.
I thought that when I met a man I loved, that I didn't need to sing. Because I think that a woman, the most important thing in a woman is to have a man of her own and to make him happy.
She had been singing all her life. And she saw herself as kind of an object.
Strangely enough, he didn't like her singing. He wouldn't let her sing on his boat. So loving him and trying to hold him, she stopped singing.
Fue otro error en la vida de María.
You need a lot of practicing, a lot of training, a lot of rest. There's so many things involved to keep an opera singer in the better shape, in the best shape possible.
She had a lot of vocal problems that were not addressed. And eventually, her voice was pretty much in shreds.
There's a famous quote that's used to show how cruel Onassis was to her, where he says to her, you know, you think you're something because you have a whistle in your throat that doesn't work very well anymore.
Ari era el centro del universo de María. Por desgracia, ella no siempre era el centro de él.
She believed, I think, that he would, in the end, give her what she wanted, which was a home, a family, and never happened.
He started also having other affairs.
En 1963, una mujer llamó poderosamente la atención de Onassis. Su nombre era Jacqueline Kennedy.
How do you do? I'm glad.
Onassis had dazzled the most famous opera star in the world. Now it seemed it was time to go after the First Lady of the United States. After the president was assassinated, Aristotle began his quiet pursuit of Jackie in earnest.
What happened was, Maria put it to me. She said, he collects famous women, and the only way he could collect this one was to marry her.
En 1967, Callas les dijo a sus amigos que Onassis la había obligado a abortar.
She said, I've always wanted a baby. And he said, well, have it then, but it will be the end of our relationship.
Too many people who were very close to her, who I interviewed, did actually confirm that she had an abortion.
Sin embargo, algunos pensaban que María había inventado la historia del aborto, porque aún se sentía culpable por la muerte de su bebé 7 años atrás, y porque estaba herida por el gran interés de Ari en Jackie.
The abortion story was just her revenge. To get back at him, to make him look bad.
El golpe final para María se dio en octubre de 1968, cuando Onassis obtuvo la mano en matrimonio de la ex primera dama.
This whole betrayal and marriage was just another operatic aspect of her life, of the woman who loves and is scorned and loses and goes crazy.
She said, I lost my weight, I lost my voice, and now I've lost Aristotle and Onassis. So she had nothing left. She had nothing left to live for.
Al regreso se inicia el último acto de la derrota y la tragedia de María Callas. ¿Podía esta superestrella vencer a sus demonios para recuperar su lugar? Onassis se casó con Jackie Kennedy en el otoño de 1968. El evento bajó el telón del romance de 9 años entre Onassis y la diva María Callas. María y Ari nunca se casaron, pero les era muy difícil salir de la vida del otro.
I left him of my own accord. We both agreed to that. Because we loved each other maybe too much.
After Onassis married Jackie, he realized he'd made a dreadful mistake. And he came running back to Maria complaining about Jackie.
A man has every right, like a woman has every right, to be able to fall in love with somebody else. There are no chains for love. I hold no grudges. I don't think it's necessary and that it's too tiring.
So she couldn't have the whole loaf, and eventually she settled for the crumbs, because at least...
María hizo esfuerzos para reanudar su carrera. Aunque estaba fuera de forma, aún podía recurrir a la actuación.
She finally agreed to do a movie of Medea, which could have started her on the road to something very exciting, had it been a success.
Pero no fue así. La película fracasó a pesar de las buenas críticas del papel de María, en el que no cantaba.
María wanted desperately to have an identity, to show an office that she was still somebody. She tried staging an opera, which didn't work. She tried her master classes, which were disappointing to her because the kids didn't really listen and respond.
People loved her for her singing, and she wanted to be loved for herself.
En enero de 1973, Alejandro Onassis, el único hijo varón de Ari, murió en un accidente aéreo. En lugar de acudir a Jackie, Onassis recurrió a María en busca de consuelo.
It was horrible for both Maria and Onassis when his son died. He became really crazed with grief over that, and he'd become rather old, almost overnight.
A pesar de la enfermedad de Ari, Callas intentó probar suerte por última vez. En el otoño del 73, la divina comenzó una gira mundial con el tenor Giuseppe Di Stefano.
Once again, she proved what a great performer she was. People came out in droves to see her. She knew at that point that her voice was not great and really felt strongly that she would have to give up the singing. In a way, it was kind of like a bird that finally kind of pulls up.
A comienzos de 1975, Aristóteles Onassis estaba muy enfermo. Casi moribundo, le envió un mensaje a María en París.
He arranged for Maria to come see him, and he told her, I love you, Maria. I'm not well, but as best as I could have, I tried.
En marzo, cuando María supo la noticia de la muerte de Ari, le dijo a un amigo que ya nada tenía importancia.
There's no doubt that for both of them, they were the great loves of each other's lives.
The end of her life was so tragic. It was so lonely. She was in Paris, and she just kind of faded away.
La otrora gran estrella de la ópera siguió siendo una solitaria durante los últimos años de su vida, además de adicta a los somníferos. El 16 de septiembre de 1977, Callas sufrió un infarto fatal en su departamento de París. Estaba a punto de cumplir 54 años.
I think she killed herself. And it's very interesting that they had her cremated 3 hours after she died. No autopsy was allowed.
A lot of people have seen something sinister about her whole death. I don't see it at all. It was just garden variety heart attack.
She changed opera forever. That is the legacy. She's a legend. She's an icon.
How many Leonardo da Vinci's are there? How many Shakespeare's? She was the Shakespeare of opera.
And yet, how can you call something a tragedy that was so glorious? I mean, we've seen her become greater in death than she was in life.
Bravo, María. Tu voz aún se escucha. Soy AJ Benza. Acompáñeme en nuestro próximo recorrido por el mundo de Hollywood.
Glitzy environment. She went skiing in the winter. He didn't like to ski. He liked to sit in his boat and drink and go out. So marriages like that tend to not to last too long.
Maria Callas was opera's most celebrated figure, with fans who thought nothing of waiting all night in the cold to hear her voice.
She's a real star in every sense of the word. She's a great actress. She's a great singer. She's a fabulous personality, you know?
Married to her impresario, Giovanni Menanghini, Callas soon won another admirer. Onassis invited the Menanghinis for a sail, which included a nostalgic visit to his homeland of Smyrna. A guest list with Winston Churchill on it was impressive to Callas, but it was the chemistry between Onassis and herself that made the trip memorable. Within a month, both Tina and Maria filed for divorce from their spouses as life imitated opera.
Menanghini reacted like a typical Italian. He cried, he screamed, he became hysterical, threatened to commit suicide, and then did absolutely nothing but ask for some money from her, which he got.
The world's two most famous Greeks began a torrid love affair that dazzled cafe society, made spicy reading in all the tabloids, and proved once again that love is blind.
I think the basic attraction between Onassis and Callas was pure sex, which had never happened to Callas before.
Menanghini had helped Maria slim down, but with Onassis, she underwent a total metamorphosis.
He made her lose weight. He took her to different dressmakers in Paris, and he made her over. And he treated her, and he was the first man to do so, he treated her as if she were a sex goddess, as if she were a sex object. And she loved it, and she bloomed, and she adored that.
The media hounded the couple.
I'm giving no interview.
The only reason why did you cut short your trip?
Please.
Are you going to marry Mr.
I said, don't. I'm not answering any interview. Now stop it.
We are very two close and dear friends. But unfortunately, this statement doesn't suit the spicy part of the press.
Anna Christina, Callas led a self-indulgent life that suited her to a fault. In spite of his disapproval, she began to neglect her singing, skipping practice sessions and even performances. The more she withdrew from her operatic career, the more disenchanted he became.
He got a bad rap. It came out that he sort of dropped her after he used her. She was finished anyway. She didn't want to practice. She didn't want to rehearse. She had worked hard all her life. Why the hell should she continue working for glory when she was very happy with Onassis sitting on the boat?
And this, ironically, was what destroyed the relationship, because she was part of this need for Onassis to have the best of everything.
They had big tempers, both of them, as Greeks tend to do. We were once in a nightclub in Monte Carlo. Everybody was enjoying themselves, and somebody said, "Tell me, Maria, does Ari ever make love to you anymore?" And she turned around and said, "Never," but in a jocular mood. And Onassis lost his temper, and he said, "Messena pote me alles poli," which means, "With you, never, with others, a lot."
A year later, when Maria became pregnant, Onassis insisted she have an abortion. His commitment to her was nearing an end.
She certainly loved him more than he loved her. But at the end of his life, he deeply regretted not having married her, not having stayed with her, because, after all, once you marry your mistress, you create a job vacancy.
A new face appeared on his horizon in the summer of 1963. Jackie Kennedy had a sister, Lee Radziwill, who was a friend of Onassis. And when Jackie's third child died at birth, Onassis invited her, through Lee, to recuperate on board the Christina. The president objected, but Jackie welcomed the chance.
I think the Kennedys were sort of too rough for her, and they never gave her enough money. And when she and Lee first came over in Greece, when Kennedy was still alive, I think she was sort of taken aback by the wealth of Onassis and the comfort. Even the President of the United States didn't have that kind of wealth.
By the end of their cruise, it was apparent that Jackie and Onassis had formed a mutual admiration society.
What Onassis found attractive in Jackie was she was the world's numero uno. She was better known than the Queen of England. She was known everywhere. And, you know, it was a natural progression for Onassis.
With JFK's assassination, the fantasy was no longer unthinkable.
I think the day Jack Kennedy died, he said to one of his aides, a man called Costa Gratzos, that is the next Mrs. Onassis. And he started to woo her very soon after Dallas. And it was the most secret long-term wooing you've ever known. I mean, he saw her more often than anyone realized. And he wooed her for 5 years.
Robert Kennedy opposed his sister-in-law's romance with Onassis, in part because of his own political ambitions. And then, in 1968, he was assassinated.
The moment that Onassis heard this, he said, "The last obstacle has just been removed. I'm going to marry Jackie."
6 weeks later, the wedding took place on his private island in the Ionian Sea.
He was the one man in the world that could supply her with the security, with the safety, with the wonderful sort of lifestyle that she wanted and had become used to. You know, he was the man that could make up for Air Force One.
Roll number two. Roll number two.
Media from all over the world descended on Scorpios. Not even on board the Christina was the wedding party safe from the journalists who were in their own boats. Any notable appearance, as that of John Kennedy Jr., provoked hysteria among the paparazzi, and the Greek Coast Guard had to restore order. His children were of one mind on the marriage.
Alexander and Christina were obviously, when you look at the pictures, were obviously in shock, like children tend to be when they see this monumental events taking place.
And it wasn't just two rich kids seeing perhaps their heritage disappearing. They genuinely believed that this was a disaster for their father, a disaster for their mother, a disaster perhaps for Jackie. Within 48 hours of the marriage, Onassis left Jackie on the island to go off and make a business deal. He left it behind. And I mean, what kind of a honeymoon is that? It's like he got the wonderful Picasso. It was on the wall. He didn't have to sit and look at it now. He was going off and doing what he did best, and that was making deals.
There was something about Kallas that was unique. First of all, the musicianship. Kallas took no liberties. Kallas could be standing, you know, just still, and everybody would be jumping around and doing all sorts of things. And she would attract the attention. All eyes were focused on her because there was a magnetic quality.
Jennifer,
Callas needed music. Callas needed the stage, you know. She was a good pianist, so she prepared, although she had nails that long, especially in her Audrey Hepburn look at one time, you know.
The filmed archive of Maria Callas on stage is surprisingly limited, although some short excerpts from the Lisbon Traviata have recently been discovered.
Harked back to the old days. I remember once we were, I think, at the Covent Garden, we were doing Traviata, and at the end of da-da-ri-da-ri, da-da-ri-da-ri, da-da-ri-da-da, A Forse Lui, she would attack this note very soft, and she'd crack it every night. And I'd go backstage and I'd say, oh, Maria, come on, attack it a little bit louder, more forte. And then when you have the note, then you can diminish it and get your effect. And this kept going night after night after night. And I said, finally I said, well, you know, you're a Greek and no use talking to you. She said, Nicola, I won't compromise. I'll crack every night, but I'm dying. And that's the way it's going to be.
Had a heyday with her, of course, because of her temperaments. And what the reasons for those are, I don't care. The end result is all that matters to me. And I found her a wonderfully gracious, and totally concentrated artist.